You ready, Mark?
Yes.
Our next speaker this afternoon is one of our international visitors. And this young man is probably the youngest ever member of Dealey Plaza UK. He's 18 years old. He's been staying in this case for 7 years. I repeat that, he's 18, and he's been studying this for 7 years. He's not really the level. He comes from Denmark. His English is very, very good, but don't try and catch him out, please, or he'll swear at you in Danish. His name is Kim Reinholdt. Kim and I have met through the internet a year or so ago. He posts a lot on the forums. His speciality is man for pup and a rifle. He owns one. He fires it regularly at weekends, he's hardly seen for it. He also has something very, very relevant to the assassination and very, very relevant to Mr. Bruder, which he will show you as well. Ladies and gentlemen, Kim Reinholdt.
Thank you, Ian. Yeah, my name is Kim Reinholdt, and before I introduce myself, I would like to say that this is not my first time in the UK only, so my first detail about the UK assassination. Now, I began researching when I saw the UK while I was filmed, and then read some books, some tables, and I finally made a publishing back in 1999. I met a famous Danish historian named Finn Madsen, and he helped me. And he opened his home and showed me hospitality. He even showed me his photocopy machine. He was just the same. And we then back in, it was back home actually. A great experience. It's all an educator, I think. It's not for Mr. Madsen and Ian. I wouldn't have been here today on that, and I'm very grateful. Now, Ian asked me whether or not it's fun to be a researcher in Denmark. It's not. We have no research communities, like, for instance, the UK. There are no real band of researchers. And there's not much in media. So I guess I'm an endangered species. The people in Denmark are in general interested in the assassination, but they found out that it's expensive and they stopped. That's too bad. And they asked me a question which I can't answer. Well, I can't, but it's too complicated. Why, after 40 years, investigated this case? What do I answer? They just say, let it rest. I can't. Now, as Ian said, I'm interested in the Kakura camera and the Kakura rifle. First, the Kakura camera. Okay. My reason for buying this camera was because I'm very interested in the historical areas and the ghosting. I won't be too technical because that's not my area. Instead, I want to show you go into an example. Can you see this? I have this about a request, and I would like to give everyone interested a copy. So just tell me, and I'll hand you one. Now, this is the fender from one of the motorcycles. You see that too. The actual frame which is being exposed when filming with the camera is the area marked with a red line. At my camera, you can actually see where the line is or where the two small squares is being produced, and I will hand you with the camera if you want. Now. If the shooter hangs 10 degrees more to the right, he has caught the off and actual attacking or on the breath mode. And that's very interesting because the last frame on the film is showing the assassin in the that we've not very accepted on Wednesday. The indicator shows, the full rest runs for about 1 minute and 10 seconds. It also has a second speed which is slow motion, and then it goes a bit faster. Yeah. Any questions for the camera?
On the full thing, they've never actually shown the frame on television, I think, as far as from where you actually see it.
Yeah.
So where from the British stop in the truck, there's always the frame that didn't have the right shot.
My experience with the camera is that it gets stuck.
And maybe the British is protected.
That's a great matter. Three rows, but mine is not part. You can see that on exhibit page 4. Unfortunately, we couldn't bring the instrument with us but we use also hose.
But why do they use clean hose? Mm-hmm. Why do they cover up the pump?
That's a question which I asked the National Archives. And I wrote them, and I got a letter back. Regarding your question about whether or not the mount or adjust the cutoff corners and repaint it, we cannot answer this question. We do not answer questions about after that or whether that could be considered interpretive or subjective. So simply answer it, and then the case is closed, and I've got to stand on our support. Okay. So I guess we can have that specific question asked. Fraser states also that the stove has been taken off the rifle before the FBI brought it. That is before the reconstruction seems to be starting before the test firing at the ballistic ranges beyond. Now that's good work. The throwing of evidence. When I shot the rifle, I must say that I became very disappointed because I had some great expectations for the rifle. I've been told by Richard Hopes, the final expert, that the rifle had been used for target composition until 1954. World-class target matches. I couldn't hit one bullet in the center. And I used 20 rounds. Up in the street. Fraser was the one who was the star witness regarding the ballistic evidence, but he was a Muslim researcher. And as I've told, she claimed a lot of untrue things regarding, for instance, the stove mount and nothing in the receiver is preventing using force on that hole. Now I know it's been made by the Christ Sporting Goods in Chicago, but they don't mention this modification in the interview in the exhibit with the one person. What is interesting also is the famous. The medicine kit belongs to CE-139, and as you know, very important when using the rifle, because I have demonstrated the rifle a dozen times. Yeah. It was marked SMI-952 and made by the Italian, the Dieta Metallurgia Italiana, in 1952, in Italy, of course. But you know, it kit usually falls out after less long chamber. Now, where's the clip? There's no clip in this matter, isn't there? There's no clip where they found the rifle. There's no clip on the saving throw on the window from saving 1962. But you see on my exhibit, case 2. In the left corner, you can see case 2 carrying the rifle from the test group of the hospital. Now, on the right side, you have been examining the rifle after it was found. These frames are from the alleged film. You can't see any sign of a clip in the receiver. But you can, on the left side, when Carl Davis turned the rifle off. We also, in the bottom corner on the right side, this is a blow-up from page 550 in with a task book. We can clearly see the rifle in the medicine dock. Why this this clip has been reinserted in the rifle after the found clip is unsure. There's no report or statement regarding the clip. And I asked Richard Hope again if it's possible that he stick in the receiver. and it said, yeah, it is greased or deformed. But you can see the plate isn't deformed, not greased.
So where did the problem start?
I don't know. So let's go on speculate. Maybe the clip stayed in the rifle after it left Ronald's chamber. It stayed in the rifle until it reached the police headquarters. Now, I think the clip, I don't think the clip looks dense. Well, it might be, I won't be the judge. Where did they find it? It's a great mystery. And before we found out where the clip was, where they found it, we can't go farther into the investigation because no clip, then we have a conspiracy. We need to solve the case about the clip before we move forward. After the Dallas police found the clip, they turned this clip and the rifle to the FBI. There are no records of the clip, I know. So the clip just turned out at the FBI trial. And how do a clip go from the crime scene to the police to the FBI without any statement or records? I don't know. Another mystery. And I'd like to anyone to figure that out because I can't. There is no agency or government institution in the United States, or in Europe, or Asia, or anywhere has been able to produce precise reconstruction of the assassination. And I don't know why. It can't be too hard. You try to have a change now. According to a phone number, Jerry Dealey, just wrote a book on the subject. So why not close the Plaza, then shoot a moving target from the sniper's nest? I don't get it. It should have done so back in 1963. But no, the government did not only throw the platform half as high as the school book was had for it, they also shot a stationary target. Not even the Russian agency will look to produce a precise test. So, yeah. This film is a poor research film, but it contains some good ideas, I think. If we can't shoot in the target, then we can make a test. Earl Brown told me that he thinks it's a very good idea, but as usual, we can't work still with other researchers, and we want to work alone, and that's a problem. I think he was an AKA Karen Blessendorf. It's not a bad thing in a cell that you only understand half of it. Now, I don't get a shit. This is a case full of questions and no answers. By this course, it's not just that in a search for the truth, you won't know every detail. The big question about what happened on November 22nd, 1963, and it'll be uncovered, though I hope it will. Yeah, that's about it, my presentation. Last of all, I'd like to thank Ian Grace for his kind offer to come to Canterbury, and also for letting me stay at his place during my visit. Very grateful to the rest of the UK board for this great opportunity to deliver a speech and to you guys, which I think is very important to the world and to the research. So I hope I've contributed just a little to the research on the assassination of JFK. Thank you.
Well, that was a
round of applause,
which was well deserved.
Thank you very much, Kim. And that wasn't easy for you. First time in England, speaking in a foreign language. It's a weird audience like this, so I congratulate you. Are there any more questions for Kim before we catch all these?
Why wouldn't they have found it out?
But
they're not looking in the right place, Mike, or perhaps they might look into the sky again.
Yeah, can, how long have you studied in the car car now, Michael?
How many years?
How many years?
I mean, yeah,
how many years have you studied that? That
only
my rifle.
Only one.
You only 1 year on the rifle.
How many years?
How many years have you studied?
Oh, 5 years.
5 years. How did they get it into the depository?
Oh, that's a question.
Do you know how they got it in there?
Yeah,
no,
we
don't know.
How do you know?
Okay.
You know how they said? Yeah, it's totally
right. Yeah. There's lots of conflicting reports that the Italian army thought it was a rubbish weapon.
Yeah.
They preferred the English or whatever. How many years was it actually produced in from start to finish, the
Sephardic? Well, then they went from 1938.
Just pre-war, yeah.
Yeah. And they
went on to
1944.
It's just basically used by the Italian army, no one else used them.
Oh, yeah, maybe.
Isn't it true to say that the Manica that allegedly Lee owned was actually the only one that had any paper trail? So Klein amazingly had the order form that he made for, amazingly still had the money order, and amazingly was still able to see in $13,000 or whatever. That's exactly the order that he... So it's not surprising that we can't find the others, because there's no paper trail.
They shipped 100,000 per ton of
really a general question really for the room. How many people actually think the Catana was actually fired on the day? By anybody?
By anybody?
Did somebody actually use it?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Unfortunately, a lot of these people have never deemed it necessary to try and find that out. They didn't bother to test that gun to see if it was fired that day. So we will never know.
Well, they think on that day, they can't now, but on that day they can
test it. Where is the gun? In the
archive? Is it complete?
Yeah.
In the
archive? And it's also totally inaccessible.
Is it?
Right, let me check all the inquiries. But from Alcom, it's impossible to get to that gun now, isn't it?
Along with many other artifacts. They've tightened up in the last 7 years, 8 years. You used to be able to get, if you were lucky, you used to be able to get to look at something.
Yeah.
But now,
you can't even look at it, you can't even hear it.
No, you've got to make a case for it. You've got to make a case for it.
I see.
Yeah. Otherwise it's going to be very accurate photographs, very definitive photographs. You can't look at the original.
They just made some new ones, actually.
Yeah, I saw them, yeah, when I saw them, they were photos.
Even you can't get to it.
No, I mean, I've got the things like the mirror.
Yeah.
And I bought the original diary, you know, his little...
But not the gun.
But not the gun.
Wow.
Yeah. The FBI said the channel was running at 18.3 frames per second. Have you been able to measure a running rate? Do you know how many frames that would have taken?
Sorry?
The 8mm film would have been 8 feet, my. The entire minute.
I don't
for the system actually. I have to pay the all of the rest of the time. I don't think I have to manage that. I haven't heard about that.
Certainly ancient Rome, you couldn't be a soldier in the Roman legion if you were left-handed.
The shield thing, that's the form of the talent.
Because they all had to work together, it was overlapping shields and swords covering the gap. If you were the wrong way around, you'd be all over.
Okay, am I right in thinking that the Catano is a carving? And if so, what is the difference between that and, say, a late entry 303?
Well, they're carved at a proceeded cost of, which is a soft right.
Yeah.
And the difference between it, because it's a paragon, is the size.
Yeah. So the other one, the same Liam's, would be heavier.
Yeah, and going right on.
Any more questions for Ken?
And once again, you get two angle pauses. Well. It's about 1996, possibly earlier. I'm going around all that time with a good friend of mine. He's a great researcher with knowledge on a lot of aspects of this case. He's written and he's been published several times on John Connolly's wounds, wrist wounds in particular, and the single bullet theory. And he's going to expand on that here and now. I think you'll learn something new here, and you'll be learning from an expert, Russell Kent. My first question is, why didn't they use regular autopsy page sheets or even diagrams from the medical textbook, which is very available to get all the questions? No, they didn't. The Secret Service actually drew these things, and they drew them incorrectly. If you take a look at them and do some measurements, you'll find that they're proportionally the body of them. I don't know why they did that, but my suggestion is for conspiracy purposes. They used the sets of diagrams twice in two sets of test units. And in the first set of test units, the doctors all said these diagrams are wrong and remarked them. In the second round of test units, they introduced the diagrams again without correcting the previous mistake. I know what these things mean, and I thought not a doctor's eye to use it, but certainly an educated eye to use some of this information, and I hope to be able to pass that to you in the simplest way I can. If I get too technical, please stop me. So, 14th of the doctor's operation on Connolly, actually
nearly as many as operated on Canterbury itself. And he's been in OR for, well, the best part of 4 hours, really. So, 14, first one was headed by this guy, Peter. He's come across him before, he worked on JFK itself. Throws a leg to the thoracic surgical team, that's the team that operated on the chest. Gregory led the orthopaedic surgical team that operated on the wrist. And then finally, Shires led the lower limb surgical team. Now, there's a full report of this in Texas section of medicine. I have a copy. If anybody needs a copy, I'll probably have some copies for you. But essentially, what that covered was each of the doctors made a report after the operation and wrote exactly what they did, right down to the sutures they used and how many they used. And then the Texas State Journal of Medicine approached him to republish those materials, basically. So it's a very good record of exactly what they did. Far more detail than anything from the article. So let's have a look at the single bullet theory. Now, I believe this diagram, it's the one that's most commonly used now to give us a good view of the government's case on the single bullet theory. It's not the one that wants, which you know this one at some point. But it does show us basically what the case is for the government. So the single bullet penetrated Canterbury and then went on to cause all the common wounds. Of course, it's essential to the government's case that the single bullet did. I'm not going to go into why that's essential because I'm sure all of you know. But the wound suffered by Connolly is critical to it. If Connolly wasn't there, there would be no need for the single bullet did. So we have to look carefully at Connolly's wounds. Some of you may have done that, but equally it's mixed. It's like looking at JFK. They don't worry about somebody. You certainly don't worry about faith. Even a meeting, you know, I mean, nothing about faith. It has to be the way the one commission says, otherwise, of course, there are more bullets, it's more cheaper, and it's good. So the testimony of the doctor contributes to the core of the one commission report. And the core is that there was a single bullet. You all know, without that, all of what Brown took and all of his five took, because what Brown is an expert on the continent. I've never been in Canada, and I started too. One of the things that he did was he did an analysis on all the questions in the Warren Commission hearing. And I thought I'd use some of his techniques and apply them to the Gregory doctors. So I came up with this table. This is the first round of questions that they were asked. It's published in the sixth hearing. And I broke it down into three different areas, including to understand what I'm going through. But it's interesting to see that the relevant questions make up a small proportion of the total. And of course, these clarification questions, you would hope there were clarification questions on the relevant questions, but they weren't always. Sometimes there might be a clarification question on something they asked at the extraordinary conclusion, or a hearsay question. Very interesting to note. The number of questions the doctors were asked and the average number of questions asked by all witnesses. So less than half. Very interesting. Let's have a look at some examples. This didn't come out so well. Some examples of what I mean by a relevant question. A relevant question would be this one. Which do you think to be the point of vengeance, Dr. Short? Now that's a relevant question. Here's that. What did Mrs. Seth Kennedy say, according to Mrs. Connolly? That's a double benefit. And a nonsense question here. I'll attempt to read this to you. I find it impossible to read. Yeah, in the answers to hypothetical questions that were addressed to you, based upon the only actual knowledge which you could base that answer, was the fact that you performed the operation on the wound caused in the chest. On the wound in the chest.
And the answer is I have to be, because you were just
talking. Well, to give you an excuse, I think the answer was yes. It strongly suggests to me that it was
diagramming.
I don't think it's edited. I think it was edited. And having read the publication in the testimony several times, I've found two or three places where I believe it was edited. And I can show those to you after. That's interesting because I'm not sure that other people have suggested that it was edited. So let's have another look at the amount of those questions. Here we go. This is the number of relevant questions asked to each doctor and the percentage of the total questions they were asked.
So in the best case, less than a third of the questions were relevant. In the worst case, only 14%. That's pretty poor, isn't it? And let's have a look compared to everything we want. So, for John Connolly's office, with our proposal of 298 questions in their first round of testimony, that represents less than a quarter of 1%, and just a quarter of 1% of the all the staff in Memorial Hospital, opposed to that concept, represents only 1.6%. And yet, this guy, Clapper, who was just actually sleeping in the evening club, turns out they're asking nearly 4,000 questions. 3.6% of the total. So here we can see, there's something going on here. And I asked my wife this morning, I said, if you could ask one person, and the whole case, a lot of questions, who would you ask? And the first person she said to me was the doctor. She said, you're right on. And guess who they asked the most questions to? Oswald's wife. So, let's have a look what it says in the report. This is very important in the report, and this is from the Connolly doctor. This is what the report would have you believe, the doctor said. And we're going to see this slide several times. In their testimony, the three doctors expressed independently their opinion that a single bullet had passed through his chest, tumbled through the wrist, punctured his left eye, and had fallen out of the side of him. I've shortened this a little bit. Everything I've taken out is not important. You can go and check it later. That's the essence, of it. So, given that it was key to the report, key to the conclusion, they expect testimony to be very easy to find. And you would expect it to have been taken by someone halfway conscious. But the testimony wasn't taken by commissioners. It wasn't taken by counsel. It was taken by assistant junior counsel. You know this, although the testimony is brief, like I said, it must be easy to find, surely. You've got the hearings and exhibits, you can get them on TV wrong now, some of you've got the hard copy, surely it's easy to find. Guess what? It's not easy to find. And in the table, complex tables are fixed schedule. If you were to do the testimony, if you were to publish it chronologically according to events, he would go in short first. He did the operation on the chest. That was the major wound. That's the one that has to be sorted for that. Gregory then operated on the wrist. That was the next most important. And Shai finally on the puncture with his son. Chronologically, you would expect this one. Have that chronological according to testimony. By time, according to when the testimony was taken. Now, like I said, they did two rounds. First round was in March 64, in this order. And the second round was in April. Ignore this one for a minute. The actual testimony, the major testimony, comes in the earlier volume. That's a problem right away. If you're reading it sequentially, you get the later testimony in the earlier volume. You're already confused. The earlier testimony comes in the later volume, and it's backwards. It's the wrong way around. Even if they did it alphabetically, you wouldn't have done it like that. Somebody deliberately did it that way. You wouldn't have got that if you'd thrown it in the air and decided which one to put in. It has to be deliberate. They buried it. Don't they do it because? What did they say? No, let's go in some detail into what these guys did. We have to start by looking at their background. Which the Royal Commission did, didn't they? They had a look at the background. They weren't very thorough, but there we go. Let's start with Shaw. This is the guy that worked on the chest wound. That was the life-threatening injury. The governor was damn lucky not to die, I think. He was the professor of thoracic surgery at the UTS at that team, University of Texas Southwestern Medical School. Professor of thoracic surgery. He was the top guy. If you've got a wound in the chest, you wouldn't want anybody else but him working on it. He's number one. He did an MD for 33 years. He's got 38 years. Since 33, he got 30 years left to do. In 1938, he had a private practice in Dallas. You can believe me that he saw chest wounds of all kinds in Dallas at that time, probably including gunshot wounds. But most of his gunshot wound experience came from his experience in the war. And guess what? He was here for a while. 2 years he spent in the UK. 2 years he spent in France. And he was the chief of thoracic surgeon in Paris. And the gunshot wound he was in Paris in 1944. He then joined the military in
guys got experience over 1,000 stone shovels, which to my reckoning is about 993 more than Spectre, who never actually saw one. So, first, he was introduced by a secret service agent, this guy Warner, who actually did the drawing, broken down. Then he had a session with Spectre, preparatory section, and so on. First session I specified in March, subsequently in April. This testing is important. It's important to the test. Why is it important? Because it's important to whether the entrance is made by a tumbling bullet. Now you've seen the Posner diagram. It has to be tumbling. If you look at the wound size, according to Posner, because it has to go through something first, which causes the bullet to tumble. It has to be a tumbling bullet. That's one thing to remember. An angle through the chest. One commission said it was 18 degrees. Well, we'll give him a little leeway, between 18 and 22 degrees. So his testing is going to be really important now. What did the bullet come from? That's the first question. Well, he didn't ask you, of course he didn't, he didn't want the wrong answer, did he? But he makes no mention in any of his reports in the Texas Medical Journal around the first thing about no hair fibers and tight fragments, nothing. If the bullet was tumbling, there would be. Guess what? Gregory talks a lot about mohair fibers and the kind of presence in the wood. Thorne doesn't mention it. Why doesn't he mention it? Because there aren't any. Gregory is asked. Gregory said that Shaw had told him, as I recall it, he said, he understands the terms of fibers and bullet presence, and I would not have expected him to be found, as I say to you, if this was the initial impact of the missile. So now we have a doctor saying, I asked Shaw, were there any bits of hair in there when he took the bullet in? He said, no, no, it was really clean. And this doctor said, it wouldn't have been clean had the bullet been tumbling. So the bullet was not tumbling, not gone through somebody's door. What about the angle through the chest? This has come out for a lot of their coat. Never mind. Shaw actually goes off record in this, when he's shown this diagram. And he says, the ocean wind is shown in the back, it's drawn too large. It has to be large. Well, the commission has to have it large, otherwise it's not a tumbling bullet. The smaller the hole, the less tumbling it is. So, he goes off record to discuss it. I'd like to know how those guys knew they could go off record. You would never be able to go off record for a commission.
Who sells off record in the transcript? Do you think they have that employee?
He asked. The doctor asked to go off record. Five times. Let's have a look at the angle through the chest. I've chucked it out. It's not tumbling now, guys. So it's not gone to anybody first.
Russell, what shot are you talking about? What shot are you talking about?
I have no idea. The one about the second one. I don't know.
I don't know.
I'm not going to go on which shot. I don't know how many shots there were. It's the one that the Warren Commission relies upon for the single bullet kill. So that's the one that penetrated Kennedy's neck, according to Penn.
Because Connolly, on record, only said he was shot by the second shot.
Exactly, yeah. I've tried not to rely too much. I've not relied at all on the proofing.
No.
You won't see anything there.
No, it's not.
And I've not relied on anything said by people. Although I agree. But John Connolly's statements support what I'm going to say.
Okay.
I absolutely agree. Yeah. And these so I grabbed a couple of photographs at random to try and look at what the angle was between these guys. Now, I thought this was a good one because it was straight on. It's not handy, isn't it? Very handy.
Yeah.
And here's another one that shows, okay, tension is slightly higher than in front of that. I'll call it that. So what was the angle for the chest? Now, I actually just picked up a drawing book I've got, an anatomy drawing book. This is a better drawing than anything the Warren Commission said, I think. You can buy this in a second-hand store, don't you? So the entrance was just here. I know it was just here because it's in his armpit and it hit his foot here. But not the shoulder blade. No, this is the shoulder blade. And here's the entrance. So I thought, well, I'll turn this around a little bit. Let's have a look like this. And now we can see an angle here. Quite a shallow angle, isn't it? So, let's have a look at the angle actually on the diagram. Now, I can't tell you what the angle actually is angle changes. So we can't say what the angle is here. All we can see is there is an angle there. And it's important because in later testimony, he changes that angle. We have no idea what it is. Because in this one, the nipple line seems down by this. He wants that nipple to be close to that extra thing. Because that's what he saw on the body. Second round of testimony, he doesn't move the nipple line down, he moves the wound up. Goes off record 5 times in the question. Mm-hmm. And the height of the nipple, that refers to where the exit wound was. Very important. And the chest wound size is very important to the thundering bullet. And the wrist wound, which he didn't treat. He's asked about it, he didn't do any less than it, he doesn't say he's asked about it. Second time on the wrist wound and about thundering and fragments. And I suggest that this smacks to me of poetry. If I say to you, I'm going to talk to you about the wound. If you have a problem with anything I'm saying, you can go off record. Mm-hmm. You would. That's what it sounds like, isn't it? So you told that. So then he has a second answer. They've had him wound once in March, then they have him again in April. This time, oh, we've got a blue ribbon panel now. Mm-hmm. Actually, Warren was there. And questions were asked by Cooper, McGroy, Fellows, Spector, and other people. And he asked a very odd question. Now, I do this purely as an aside. One of the initial questions from Dulles, he asked about Medicare, and Dr. Shaw says, oh, that's set up by Tom Dooley. Tom Dooley, I've got a phone number. He said, I have a gig. It turns out that Dulles was talking, yes, I know him well. He was the man in Yale. I think he was. The man in Yale. He turns out to be a CIA informant in Yale, and he submitted 500 reports on new things of truth and things like that. And no wonder Dulles knew it.
Very interesting.
Then he was no longer directing. He was no longer directing. And he's much better than that. I think. If anybody wants to follow that, I've got some more information about him. So, like I said, his strong suggestion of coping between the sections. And Spectrum introduces what he calls a new set of diagrams. This is the quote. The diagrams aren't new. They're exactly the same set of diagrams. And the things that Shaw marked them on this first set are not shown on this second set. So I wonder whether the government's hoping that it'll just do something different or you'll forget about the problem you had in the first one. And he says in the sector says these will require remarking. Why do they require remarking when they've marked up once before? Well, because he needs Shaw to change the position of the wound. But he does. He moves it from here. And now look at the angle. Much different. So now I've got, how many angles have I got? I've got the angle that I might be able to work out on the photograph. I've got the angle that I've worked out by marking up some anatomy drawing. And I've got two angles that I've marked up on Gregory diagram. What was the angle? Nobody knows. Isn't that incredible? The body's there, it doesn't know. They don't know what the angle was. I find it because in the next session, we looked at another diagram and they marked another angle for the body. This time the Warren Commission had it at about 45 degrees and thought that might be a bit shallow than that. Now I've got 6 angles. What's going on? Things become even worse at the Warren Commission. It gets very bad. It also is about the finger bullet for 3D299. I don't know what sure that is. I feel there would be some difficulty in explaining all the wounds that have been inflicted by the system. Immediately after he says that, he goes off record. I wonder what they were discussing.
He said the right thing.
And he gets another of this proof and it showed him some slides from the computer film. They didn't actually show movie bits on it. I don't think, unless they need to know the difference. He says, in sequence of films, I think it's hard to say that the first bullet was supposed to be made only from the film. Now, let me bring this up, is that this is what they said. In their testimony, three doctors said that independently, a single bullet had passed through his chest, some of his work was from falling out. Shaw didn't say that. He didn't say anything like that. He said the opposite of that. Anybody believe that Shaw said that? Let's have a look at what the other doctor said. Surely they support the Warren Commission. Surely somebody must have said it, otherwise they couldn't publish it, could they? Have a look at Gregory then. War and the US Navy. He's in the Korean War, supporting the 1st United States Marine Corps. This guy's a decent one. He's actually got 500 guns up by the time coming wheeled into the war. He knows what he's doing in the war and he's caused by gunfire. He's interviewed by the FBI, sir. Then he's interviewed by the Secret Service and they produce some diagrams. Then by Spectre. And this is all before he gets to doing testing. Then he's interviewed by testing in here and subsequently, and we'll talk about it in a bit more detail. Why is Gregory's testimony important? The risk was whether it was made by a prison bill like the being treatment or a form for it. You have to know that. The government says it was 398-CP-399. And the director of the same place in Google for it. The government says it went in here and got out here. Probably. Gregory says, this would imply that an irregular missile passed through the wood rim. What would imply? It's all to do with fixing it in the wood. He also says, an irregular missile can carry debris into the room, such debris was carried into the room of the rim. An irregular missile, not a single word, not something that's been set, but not like the thing you've seen in the And what was the trajectory then? That's the second thing. The sector shows Gregory this diagram and says, I've marked up the event for next week. Is that correct? Gregory says, no, you're wrong. You've got me the wrong way around, Peter. You didn't go in here and come out here. This is the other way around. You went in here and out here. But you're holding your wrist like this, you've got some front. That's pretty interesting, isn't it? That destroys the case for me. Absolutely destroys that. One diagram destroys the case for me. So this time, in the second line of testimony, he's asked lots of questions by the blue ribbon panel. You might notice these are the same people as were asked Short. And that's because they were in the room at the same time. Short and Gregory gave their testimony the second time round together. Never did that. You know, if Shaw says something, he's a professor of surgery. Another professor of surgery is very unlikely to get up and say something wrong. You don't usually do that in a court. But this wasn't a court, was it? It was only Canterbury. He gives five reasons for the trajectory to be in here, out here. And I've been through those before, you've probably seen that. Except he needs it to be the other way around. And he verses him again, and he gives him the diagram again, and he hopes that he won't see it this time. He sees it, and he remarks it. And he thought he's not having it, except he won't. But twice, the guy who treats the Connolly, professor of orthopedic surgery, says the special got it wrong.
The other one's definitely good at number, right?
And he said that thing gets very unraveled when he's shown the single bullet. In 399. Spectre asks, who felt the projectile has inflicted all the wounds? Gregory says, I believe firmly that the probability is much diminished. No, it's in there. Then he shows him some other things, some other bits of bullets that were allegedly found in JFK's room. Here they are. It doesn't look like seeing 399. Talk about it. It actually looks something. Gregory says, one of these that seems to me to be singular to the European doing this. Now, if it's one of these guys, it's not CD399, so the single bullet theory, it doesn't work. And we've got two reasons. Just from Gregory, the single bullet theory, you can put in 50%. Interestingly, to me, these two fragments are wrongly referred to in the testimony by Spectre. You give them wrong numbers. Fragments allegedly, the same way that the Bruder claim, was it 3-1-3 and 3-1-4 were reversed when they were published? But these are wrongly referred to. And actually, what's in the testimony, I'm only here in perspective, what's referred to in the testimony, a comparison between two bullets. You can't actually see what they are.
Mm.
That's what Gregory was talking about, but that's not what's in the theory. That Gregory favours any bullet, that's from any bullet except the 3299. When discussing the bullet of Sanford JFK, Kelly said, even a fragment of that speaking inside to respect the government's arms. So he'd go for anything except the 3299. Look at that testimony at Mexico. It says, in their testimony, he got to say, you don't have anything in that single bullet, past week, just come to the bullet, come to the Gregory didn't say it either. Shaw didn't say it, and Gregory didn't say it. How did they have the best strength of that? I have no idea. I have a look at Gregory 5. You know this one. Very famous one, isn't it? And down here it says, it indicates the path of the projectile through the body, as indicated by examination of the wound. Not by any examination of the wound by any doctor. I can tell you that. That is a very misleading caption. And that diagram now looks like at least a 45-degree angle through the chest. It also shows the penetration of the wrist incorrectly. And that's what you would say that you believe. That's what treatment is for.
So why is that called Gregory Exhibit 1? Did Gregory see this picture and say, oh yes, that's what happened?
He was showing it. What are you showing it? And what are you doing? You said that, but I have that before. So here we go, another angle through the chest.
An offhand sketch not intended to be used as final authority.
Yeah, it's an offhand sketch not intended to be used as the final authority about how the government was actually fitting. It makes it indicate a part of the wound through the body. It doesn't do either of those two things. Let's just copy this and put JFK behind, not to be in a position where he might have had an exit wound in the throat. And let's have a look at what that actually suggests then looks like. Well, that would have us believe that JFK was hit in the head and then out of the throat, and he was sitting about 2 feet above some of it. And clearly he wasn't sitting up right on some of it. But this, ladies and gentlemen, well, politely put it, but I feel that. Let's have a look at Shire, the least important of the doctors, because the wound in the thigh probably would have healed up on its own. Didn't need a lot of surgery. Thank you for either this, which means they took all the damaged tissue away. But it didn't need a fantastic surgery to do it. However, it was a professor of surgery in the district. Top guy, another top guy, 15 years experience, speaking as a social medical student. That's what I was interested in. He was on a hospital trip, and it doesn't actually say how many gunshot wounds he's treated, but you can believe in 15 years. Part of that time in the US Navy and a lot of that time in Dallas, he's been abused. He again was interviewed by the FBI, Secret Service, the terrified sector, but he only gave testimony once, and only 72 questions were asked. Why was he interviewed on our board? He was interviewed on our board because he treated us.
Sorry, you asked our board to get in
the shot. His testimony is important. It's important whether the bullet penetrated commonly's thigh, because that's what they said. Look, punch to the left thigh and swing them out the thigh. Well, let's see. Does the doctor say that? He says the skin wound was either a tangential wound or a large fragment that penetrated the top of the skin and subsequently fallen out. Now, a large fragment to me doesn't mean a bullet. If he meant a bullet, he would have said a bullet.
Mm.
He wouldn't have said a large fragment. And if it was tangential, this diagram is wrong again, because that's not a tangential shot, that's broken. Tangential shot, go ahead. Here's something really interesting that I didn't know before either. I dug this out of Wisecrack. Dr. Perry was interviewed by Wisecrack, and he said that Shire called him in to give him an opinion on the finding because Perry was an expert on arterial injury. They were worried that the governor might have an injury to his femoral artery. Of course, Perry, so no joking. And Perry told Wisecrack that the hole was too small for a bullet to have killed it. Oh, that's the first one. And the fragment next to the penis could not have been deposited by a whole bullet that then backed out. Of course, one piece you never lost these times. That's the Wisecrack. my reading of the testimony, my reading of the book that I've done in the last couple of weeks, this fits far better than anything the warrant committee did. I'm not saying this is the right one, but given their little drawing here, we have the penetration of the wound of the chest, which is probably at about 18 degrees. Not 45 degrees, not 22 degrees, not only the other degrees, 10 degrees, all the other degrees that they have. They had a wound in the wrist. It went that way down. It didn't go this way. It went that way. And had a tangential wound on the side. And I can't say that's true, but it won't put it still. Where I broke up and caught the other end. It certainly wasn't the way the one used to say that. But I think it's a bit in the church. A chance to ask the question.
Is it possible then, Russell, that the bullet actually hit the radius bone in his wrist and then fragmented?
Yes.
Or
in fact, they didn't see the entrance wound at that point of it. Because the entrance wound was about 5 centimetres above and sliding towards the thumb side of the person, just like this. Mm-hmm. The exit wound was actually increased, but if you do this with the wrist, it was increased in the exit wound, there was a slip in there, and they hardly saw it. But yes, it could have been fragmented.
I've heard it discussed as to whether or not Connolly could possibly continue to hold on to his hand if he'd been wounded. He has.
Yeah.
If he'd been wounded, could you see clearly right up the frame 2/5?
Yeah.
He's holding his hand.
Some
people said that his hand was broken in color. One of the doctors said this.
There's a lot of confusion about this. The nerve that was actually injured was on the nerve, which is a sensory nerve. That means it carries sensation away from the hand to the brain. Not emotional nerve. So, I don't really know what to tell you. It would have felt like hell.
Well, that
nerve would have been severed.
Given that Connolly really felt the chest pain, it's the only wound he noticed. I mean, when he sat down, said he didn't notice that he'd been hit in the hand, on the wrist, or in the thigh. He didn't feel anything there. He didn't notice anything about it.
Yeah.
He only felt the chest pain.
Yeah.
Now, do you think that's possible? Or likely, given the nature of that risk. I mean, in fact, Connolly's word for it might take that at face value, but do you think that's a little strange sounding, or would you just
No, I don't think it's strange. There were 10 centimeters in the ridge bone, and the struggling through that sort of thing.
But he didn't even feel it or notice it until afterwards, and
I think he was in so much pain. Yeah.
But I'm sure to say that it's, you didn't need to do it.
And I think the risk was like because of the exit wound.
I'm not disputing what you just said. I'm just asking whether or not he would have been able to hold on to the hat.
I don't think
if he had his wrist penetrated.
He smashed his radius bone, and most people would drop whatever.
Just because the muscles rely on that bone being strong enough to hold the hat.
It's not an automatic thing, like, it's not going to be a reflex on the reflex position of the hand is not close. It's difficult to say now. Anybody else? Well, thank you very much. Oh, sorry.
That slide is the tangential entry.
Didn't Connolly, when he fell over onto his wife's lap, if I remember that's what happened?
Yeah.
And he was more or less lying with his head and upper body on her lap, pouring out blood from his chest.
Yeah.
And his leg would have been exposed.
Yeah.
He was sitting up, his left leg would have been exposed to anything to the rear or anything on
the head with headshot.
It could have been a ricochet.
Yeah. It wasn't a whole bullet.
been any response from anybody to counter this at all? I mean, has it gone out in front of anybody and they said, well, no, this isn't right, this isn't this, that? Has it been going to somebody who would have a much more, let's say, a reason to sort of say this is rubbish?
I was
asking you whether you've taken it, because this is obviously very important, if this is all can be proven and something like that, has anybody who was actually sort of like a positive kind of person kind of had a counter to what you've actually kind of come up with? Because it would seem that was the subject of what you might call critical analysis and
the
critical
amount. It certainly means that, because I've extracted from their testimony now, somebody else will come along and extract some material from their testimony which tends to support them. I can get that because spectral art is the question.
Yeah. I'm just asking whether what you've got there, has anyone you shown that to somebody who would
have any kind of
interest? Can you quote an example of one of those leading questions, so that people really know what you mean by a leading question? My goodness, that's a leading question.
Yeah.
Can you paraphrase on a spectral question?
On a spectral question, given the fact that there was a rifle above and from behind firing high velocity shots at 2,000 feet per second, and the dart was holding a fixed dart in the neck, and the bullet exited the neck and then hit the gun, would that be consistent with a bullet? And it would go, well, yeah, maybe.
I guess.
But then they fresh doubt from the same answer.
Yeah, that's right. And
they
think
things like possibly, but I doubt it, or something like that.
Yeah, they do.
Well, it's a very unlikely.
Yeah, exactly. I think there's probably a bit too much.
Just to underline your point, then, so there's nothing in the Warren testimony that gives any reason to test these statements.
Not if you throw out hearsay, questions of course for conclusion, although these could be expert witnesses, and
this is where I got it from. We might say it wasn't really good evidence, but we might say this vibration is testing. Anything remotely.
Yes, we would be able to support it.
The divine version of
it. On their version of it. Yeah. The problem is that it's not medically fair. And if we rely on some documents from dry guns or things so it is very good. And then just address it. It's very obscure, it's very, and it's backwards, and it shows them twice and does them new. And so it's a game there.
Is there any kind of referencing to that testimony by testimony in court? The testimony that he's using?
I'm not sure. It's not very good at saying. It does have some sort of evidence. Because in that kind of statement, it has to be supported by all the testimony and all the data, and it simply isn't.
Yeah, Russell, the doctors say that the bullet that hit his wrist was fired from the front. So how do they...
The entrance was actually in the
front here, just the front part of his wrist. Yeah. Did that have anything to do with his chest wound, of course?
You don't know. But one of the things that's interesting to try and find out is if you could get an accident when you hit, going into your wrist. Well, I can't say my wrist. If they put you, if you're sitting down, and I put my hand like this, and I get exit here.
Yeah.
I probably can make it this. Yeah. I probably can make it.
So that would just lead to one bullet then?
Yeah. So people saying this, I can't put my wrist here, therefore it's unpacking, that's not correct.
No.
Yeah. The other question I have is the single bullet theory that it had to be a ventral. Ventral to go. From the smooth side, it's gone to the hairy side.
Yeah.
The reason they said that was because that was the position his arm was in during the time when Kennedy was definitely shot from behind. bullet, presumably for arguments per se, and then they take him off from the cliff. There's no other reason other than that fact that he had his hand in that position during those frames. They say that's when that hand must have been shot. But assuming that you're right, I think it's quite possible, and that the wrist wound occurred at a later time during the say possibly a fragment from the head wound or something.
Yep.
Where would the bullet that went through the chest in the downward direction have ended up? Where is it?
Good question. Mm-hmm. Yeah, a very good question. Because it all relies on the bullet that I refuse to rely on. You don't see it anymore.
Well, regardless of that, the man was sitting in the limousine at about what we call frame 236. He was hitting the back and the bullet, and his body has a hole in the back that's an inch between, and a hole in the front that's an inch between, and the doctors all agreed on that.
Yeah.
Where's the bullet?
I guess it got through the gun.
And why did
it? Maybe it wasn't the bullet. Maybe it wasn't the bullet.
Okay. I mean,
you know,
there are a lot of possibilities, but that one wasn't.
Probably had to end up in the fire. I think it probably would have been like a jacket for the red spectrum. Probably ended up in the car. But we know nothing about the evidence in the family.
But now,
if
anyone
did
the surgeons actually respond to this post the Warren report? Was there any response? They looked at what was actually written. Is there any evidence that they responded to this? You know, they presented with this completely contrary to what they had said in the report. So,
well, what was interesting was, I tried to answer the question, but the report in the Texas notes that says at the beginning was published before the warrant was issued. So that was no accurate description of how it came from. That's what it was. I believe they were tested. They were probably told not to. Not to I think a lot of the data was quite
scared. So they would have perhaps just said, there's another record here from Texas between.
How many people read that?
But it's there.
Not even medical.
But again, yeah. It's a public record. Historically, yeah, it will be there. So it's just curious as to whether they, you know.
They never went back and said, yes, definitely.
No,
they did it.
No, it's a problem.
Yeah, it's probably not.
Did Michael, were there any photos or x-rays really at the time or later on?
Yes, they were. Yeah, they were. The only problem I've got comes from the Warren Commission exhibit, and if you've ever looked at things, it's a very poor version of it. I believe the experts at the time was actually in the presentation from the Boston stuff. You can see a fragment in the section, you can see a fragment in the rest of the section, and even the autopsy doctors there say also that they did not allow that much material.
Yeah, in your opinion, how many shots on the day do you think are specifically fired from?
You know, I get asked that question sometimes. That one and who did it first?
Mm.
So that's why I'm interested in it. I can't actually answer those questions. Well, I can give you a guess.
Yeah, in the fact that more than a layman would, in the fact that you've got a degree in ballistics or whatever, what's your best stab at it?
Well,
just going from the wound. Yeah, going by everything you've tried, you reckon?
Yeah.
There's allowing for a nick.
That's allowing for any wound you get came from it.
Mm-hmm.
If you put in tape, that's six. If you put in the shot that you're supposed to have got, that's seven.
And what about
the liquid tape? Because it's always putting that hole, but it's always thinking it's putting that thing to grow up.
Mm.
So maybe there were fewer, but they broke up.
Is there anybody writing on those? Nobody's going to believe this.
Yeah.
I don't know much about paid injury, but I want to know if you've had injuries.
Yeah.
Is it a definite bullet, or could it be a fragment, or could it be a sort of concrete?
Yeah, it could have been a fragment of bullet, or a bit of concrete. And it could have come from a whole bullet, or a fragment of bullet. And it's sort of strange. I thought to myself when I was driving it to look at the appropriate pavement, and all that.
Yeah, in relation to the percentage of CE-399, what was the percentage of grams missing from that bullet?
Very little, wasn't it? It weighs 151
grains. And how many grains?
1.6 grams missing.
There were grains missing from that bullet.
Yeah,
but it was within the variation on range of that idea.
And of course, when it was shown, it had already been tested by the FBI.
So, yeah.
Twice they believed that all of them were missing from the FBI.
Right.
Okay.
Probably just like 6
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
yeah,
average
so
161.
Yeah, so we see people like that in the way and squeeze one in the fly, they get to get out and cut things 41 pieces and so there you go, there's loads of people. It could easily happen. I wrote to them and said, with respect, do you understand that the number of pregnancies is irrelevant? It's the weight of them than that.
Yeah.
Good answer. Yeah, like I said, there's many other ways of not being able to.
Right. Well, what he said was that he was not hit. Well, he said definitely he was not hit by the friend
by the friend.
Believing that there were only three shots, as everybody said,
yeah.
He said, I was hit by the second shot and I never heard it.
Yeah. And then he has no idea.
He heard a shot, looked around, then he was hit. That's all he remembers. And I personally think that is absolutely accurate.
Yeah.
Testimony that no doubt is not telling the truth. Not only. As you see, but that is really what happened.
Okay.
Yeah, but if he was hit by the second shot, he wouldn't be worried about whether there was another shot anyway.
What do you mean he wouldn't
be hurt? Well,
because
he'd be hurt.
He said something else that was very funny, wasn't it?
He'd be hurt, wouldn't he?
Because he thought somebody was firing rapidly and that was an automatic weapon.
Is that right? I don't think he said that. Well, your point is that he may have been hit
but he was already hit when Kennedy suffered the fatal headshot, wasn't he?
Yes,
he was. Yeah, so he wouldn't have, even the man even without that, he was falling out.
He was
dying then, yeah.
Do you think with the custom landing, that was only a big colony, that the shot that he did was actually aimed at him and not a risk of eternity?
Funny to say, it was a big, I think New England said it was then, but he was going for the government. And he actually wrote to the government, it was a whinging note, didn't he, from the government.
That's also true that the colony personally wasn't supposed to be in that scene. Is it not that Yardley was supposed to be shooting him?
Well, I don't know, but I'm involved with that.
Yeah, he was, because there was an argument between Connolly and Kennedy in the hotel, and somebody came in and wanted to know what the row was about, and that's what it was. And they said, well, if Yardley doesn't like it, he can get out and walk.
yeah,
not Texas connection, yeah.
Texas some people believe that. He wasn't right. A lot of aimed at Connolly, his own, they were aimed at Jackie, they were aimed at Faye, and the scene that he did with Canada to have
it.
Mm. I thought Pogner, I think, about Lent Le Home, he had a chapter on this in the book that he was talking about.
Yeah.
I know Weisberg wrote about it, but I couldn't think that was a very good rebuttal of my book. The book he wrote, Post-Reopen.
Case closed, huh?
Very soon after,
he's a brilliant man and knows much to anybody about the case, and he is, so I think.
Yeah,
but he wasn't brilliant like.
No,
but
my
deputy needed medicine.
Yeah, look, my question is, and others would be expecting them to know about it, is there, has there been a good rebuttal of cognitive?
Yes, yes, I have to say yes, they have, but it is pretty good for it. No, no, it's in one place. In a number of decades, Germany.
Yeah. Who was that German guy on TV, you know, Russell, that came up with another theory on the laser side of things? Do you know anything about that at all?
No, I don't know anything about that. I put this together. I'd already done it with Gregory Lydon.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And I thought, you know, some people here were there and I did that. And I thought, what could I do with a bit more interesting? And maybe a bit further.
Yeah.
And it was about 6 weeks ago.
It's amazing.
Still taking it.
So the test then, in Texas, where it brings it, so we can...
Yeah, we've gone through the next, yeah. Mm. But Mantic probably just...
Is that one picture?
Yeah.
The back end with the non-penetration wound, that in itself destroys it, doesn't it?
Yeah,
it does. And it's overkilling it, how many times do you want to destroy it?
I warned you to get something good, didn't I? Russell goes to great lengths to explain where the Warren Commission report varied from what's in the Warren Commission 26 volumes. Don't ask him to quote anything right here and now, because I can't, but there are other examples of this throughout the Warren Report and the Warren Commission volumes. There was something to the right on the clip, I can't remember what it was, but the Warren Report said, blah, 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 and what's his statement, and you will find this, and there was a footnote, in the volume that was, and it wasn't there. It isn't there. And they've done that deliberately, I feel. The Warren Report was meant to be purchased by Go Public in America in large numbers, and then the volumes came out, I think, about 3 months later, and very few people bought the 26 volumes. I believe even up to date now, there's only 5,400 cassettes being sold in America. People who bought the report swallowed it. They were meant to swallow it. Obviously, their own case closed. And then the Warren Commission, the government, felt obliged to produce their evidence in the 26 volume. Virtually certain that nobody would bother to compare the two. Now, that's my view. I can't believe that's true. Mm. But what Russell has given us here is just one example of that. As far as I'm concerned, I've heard Russell's theory before, and several others have. But if he was shot through there, it didn't come right there. It's as simple as that, wasn't it, in layman's terms? That's my view. Have I got that right, Russell?
Well, if it was shot...
Oh, he had the picture of his arm on the car.
The only picture he's got on his fear from, I do believe that he was shot in the car like that. So yes, yeah.
I remember when Russell first gave this presentation, or an embryo version of it, in, I think, Waltham Abbey, at one of their early meetings in the late 90s. And you had our then chairman, Richard Lewington, up from the audience. And he had him sort of twisted in bits like this, with biro marks, or tilted, not like
his
arm, it was showing where he did it. Just impossible. It was just completely impossible. So, Russell, thank you.
Well, I'm fine as well.
Well, you're on time for dinner now, so thank you. And he just told me he attended that first meeting. you know Mike, he publishes a journal, he's been to many of our meetings, he's much respected. A lot of us owe a debt of gratitude, thanks to Mike, we have that meeting place in the University of London Student Union. Mike's going to give us what promises to be a very, very interesting account of eyewitness analysis, I suppose you can call it, a new interpretation of the eyewitness account of the shots in Dealey Plaza. So please put your hands together, Mike Gorski.
Everybody should have a little piece of paper. Thank you, Jim.
Well, Kennedy was killed. Kennedy was assassinated.
Right, what happened? Does anybody know what happened? Nobody knows.
No.
Okay, that's right, nobody knows. But somebody knows. I have a number of questions I'd like to ask you. Now, you've always given a piece of paper, and I've deliberately tried to talk over what you were hearing, those who are in attempt to be sound shots. I want to ask you some questions. Write down how many shots you heard. And there was interference, I was distracting you. Listen. How many shots did you hear? Write them all down. Now, when remembering back and thinking about sounds you heard, how much time elapsed in seconds between first and second sound? Just your best estimate. Don't have to count seconds, don't have to feel anything. Just try to remember and write down what you think it was. And if you can remember there were more than two sounds, maybe you only heard two, how much time elapsed between the second and the third sound? Think about those questions, write them down on your piece of paper, and please pass them to my lovely assistant, Isabel, down here. She's a little collector here. She's going to just take a look and, Isabel, would you have time during my talk to tally these answers and give you approximate averages of what people have said?
Isabel?
Just pass them down to the end, Isabel, I guess you can't, because you're so simple. Okay, well, while you're doing that, Isabel, I'm going to begin my talk, which I've entitled Eyewitness Account of the Shock, a New Interpretation. Now, why do I say it's a new interpretation? Because all the old interpretations have pretty much missed the point of the eyewitness testimony about the shock completely. So this is new. Has been seen before in prison. It's not a rehash of anyone else's theory, as far as I know. It's all new stuff. Now, there's never really been a proper study of what witnesses in Dealey Plaza actually said about the time of the shot. If you go back and look in the Warren Commission discussion, sort of transcript of what they said, stuff that is in the 26 volumes, that's sort of publicly available in discussion during testimony and things. Alan Dulles at one point mentioned, yes, didn't most of the witnesses actually say something about there was more time between the first and second shot than between the second and third shot? That was the full extent of the detailed analysis of what witnesses said. Other people pointed out, not all the witnesses said that, Mr. Dulles. Or Alan, if you know. Alan. The House Select Committee on Information conducted an extensive study and hired a psychologist from Harvard University to do a study on witness perception, not of what the witnesses have said in the Plaza, not the Plaza, but whether if somebody fired a rifle in your ear, next to your ear, whether you can tell where the shot came from. And I think the answer is somewhere over there. Okay, witnesses were very clueless telling where shots came from the sound of the shot. The reason for this is very simple. Bullets are supersonic and create the sound of their own as the shockwave passes through ears, and it sounds like it comes from a direction about 90 degrees away. So unless you actually see the muzzle flash or puff of smoke or something, you're not absolutely sure where the shot came from just from the sound alone. That was the conclusion of Harvard's professor. But he didn't say anything about what the witnesses said about the spaces between the shots. So all of these sources discussed in the assassination in terms of what witnesses said about the shots simply state we think there were three shots, and one of the things that supports this idea is that most witnesses said they heard three shots. That is more or less true, but it's not true of all witnesses. Something else came along after the Warren Commission. In 1967, CBS conducted a special investigation into Walter Cronkite as a narrator, and they made a detailed analysis of all sorts of things having to do with the Warren Commission and single bullet theory and the possibility of making the
expert rifleman and so forth. And I think they managed just barely to get one expert that just barely achieved what Oswald did after many, many attempts. Or what Oswald supposed to do. But during their study, Luis Alvarez, the Nobel Prize winning physicist, noticed, was asked about this, and he said he noticed that on the Zapruder film, if you look at it frame by frame, he was only looking at originally at the pictures that were in the 26 volumes, which if you've ever looked at them, are very poor reproductions, that you can see sudden jumps and wiggles and little streaks, indicating the camera was moving very fast for a big period of time. In the point of the camera, he noticed that these tended to occur in places where there was a likelihood of a shock that caused an injury that was visible on the film. JFK doing this, Connelly doing this, JFK doing that. He found that there were squiggles or jiggles on the film. He did an analysis of this. And then in 1976, 9 years later, fairly quick publication, he did a more formal paper in the American Journal of Physics in which he presented his conclusions. Now, this is one of the diagrams in that paper. The House Select Committee expanded on these ideas and did their own jiggle analysis, which I don't think necessarily made much of an improvement on computers, but this on Alvarez. But this was Alvarez's basic conclusion, that if you look through the frame numbers in the Kruger film, there are places where there are sets of very rapid motions due to jiggling. There, 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 there. There's a little tiny one here that's probably not meaning anything. There's one here, and then there's a big one here, or there's a little one here, and then big squiggles here. So they think, now these are not due to further shocks, these are due to the crew holding the camera, whereas there's some, Kim, you hear Kim? Yeah, I mean, I don't suppose you ever tried taking a cine film and shouting and jumping at the same time. This came out of jiggle. Yeah. So I think this is the Bruder saying something, my God, they shot him, or something like that, and shouting something. And of course, if you're jumping and shouting while you're filming, you get jiggled. And that's probably what that is after the well-known headshot claims to on three. But the Bruder's basic analysis says everything was fine until the first shot. A few frames went by while the sound traveled to Kruger's ear, and he had an involuntary reaction and flinched. There's the first shot. Okay, so the first shot had to be somewhere in the 170 frame count. This is before Kennedy passed behind the road sign. Now, actually, we should have had that for the Kruger film here, and I don't have a copy to bring along to. Should have done that. Would have been worth looking at the frame numbers on it. But that's probably the best indicator that there was an early shock. Now, there's one talking about those of you who know about security concept. No, there is a tree in the way between the sixth-floor window and the car. One of two things happened. Either the shooter was an idiot and shot at something he couldn't see with a very high probability of the bullet deflecting. Well, the shooter wasn't actually in the window. Or Alvarez is wrong and that isn't shot. But I think Alvarez is almost certainly right that it's a shot, because immediately thereafter, until the point when Kennedy goes behind the sign, he sees matching in the car just before Kennedy disappears from view behind the sign. You see him in earlier frames, he's doing something like this, right? Like this, waving at people, smiling, hoping to get somebody's head, maybe. We all know about this.
Yeah.
So I'm just looking to scare us in action. Suddenly, possibly turning to look exactly at Jesus and look at him at the same time. And then they disappear behind the sign and we can't see what happened. But I think a lot of people feel that probably, shot that missed, we're looking at each other. We don't know that for sure. It might have been a shot that hit, and that effectively shot that hit the straight line. Yeah. And then a second or so later, he emerges at frame 223, at the other whatever it's called. He said, he's saying he looks calm, there's no blood on his shirt, or anything like that. And then suddenly there's a reaction from Connolly right about here. He's been hit. We don't know exactly where it is. There's a little squiggle there. But the printer, he sends the algorithm, interpreted it. But the squiggle's on the film. The first shot here, the 170, the second shot at about frame 215, the sound reached the printer at 220. And the third shot, of course, at frame 313. Because all the witnesses said there were three shots. But all the witnesses, he thought, so there were three shots, there were three shell casings, supposedly for this and this four windows. And there were, at the time, they said, well, we've got three wounds, of course. We don't have three wounds as well, but we happen to have a lot more than that. Notice that this means the first shot and the second shot had to be very close together in time, followed by a long gap. Each of these trips is about a second and a half, so there's about one, this is 215, 175, 18.3 frames per second.
Mike, did you say there were three shell casings?
Yeah.
So if the fourth bullet is the magic bullet, that means there were four shots fired.
I'm not talking about magic bullets or anything.
Okay.
I'm just talking about how many shots there were and what time they were. And here's a diagram showing the recruiter's position. Here's the first shot fired through the tree, like it was one. The second shot fired not long afterwards, and a long time later, 313. So some of that bang, 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 bang. I think that was no shot, bang. About like that. Now, if that's true, and all those witnesses heard three shots, shouldn't they all be saying, I heard bang, 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 bang. Did any of them say that?
No.
No, not very many. A few do, but not very many. Notice the assumptions built into Alvarez's conclusion. The first assumption that the jiggles probably, in some cases, represent chunks. It's true. I'm sure he's right about that. I have no argument. Some of the other jiggles are what I call the mom effect. I'm referring to my late mother, who had the occasional opportunity to use the family city camera. And she had this wonderful habit, you can see it if you find any world movies, but if she's filming something over there, and people walk by, as they're walking by, she goes, like this with the camera, trying to get past the people. And possibly, as Kennedy disappeared behind the sign, those big squiggles that you saw here, they're sort of a mom effect. Oh my God. Or in some sense, no crap. Because he's hoping to get a really good picture of the presidential visit, and instead he got a picture of the back of a freeway sign here, and no president. So he might be saying, no butter, or something. So that's what Alvarez's analysis requires. If we believe there are three shots, we have to believe all the witnesses should say something like this. Do they? Well, I'll come to that in a moment. Now, we go back to the House Select Committee analysis. Remember they found a Vic DeBelt in amongst the records, an old police Vic DeBelt recording. And both Baranak and Newman, well-known government think tank consulting firm, set up was contracted to do a study, and this was done by James Barger and Mark Ashkenazi. And they studied the sound or impulses on the dictabelt. And although it doesn't sound like shots, is what I did before, wasn't shots, it was me tapping a phone, a pen on a tile, very close to the end of the microphone. They found that, this is what we've all heard, that they analyzed the pixel and they found four shots. If the three came from the vicinity of the Texas School District Depository, or they couldn't tell, it's conceivable some of them could have come from the Dow Tech building, which is across the street from the book depository, also in line with Elm Street. And that they also found one shot with a 95
25% probability from behind the grassy knoll, from behind the fence. And Kim showed you a picture of a man in a black hat standing behind the fence, black hat, the bad guy, standing behind the fence. In exactly that position, taking that one shot paint just about where that man was standing. That may have been deliberate. So that was deliberate planning that man was standing there. So their patterns had two shots, 1.65 seconds apart, jammed with 6 seconds, down, 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 bang, bang. Two shots very close together, bang, bang. One of which came from the grassy knoll, and everybody else said, yeah, but that one happened to miss. I don't necessarily believe that. Now, I've undertaken a study of the statements that eyewitnesses made from Dealey Plaza. They're all standing around in all sorts of various places in the Dealey Plaza area, mostly in front of the Texas Tools Repository, somewhere along Houston Street, and somewhere, of course, along Elm Street or in the grassy area between. So let's see, what did they say about the time and the number of shots? And so we'll call them ear witnesses rather than time. It's just about what the people heard. Well, witness accounts seem to vary widely. It seems to vary widely. This is why the Warren Commission did try to make sure they could deal with it. Actually, that's not true. There are, in fact, a few different ways in which most witnesses describe the shot. Three categories of witnesses. Well, I found testimony from 71 witnesses or affidavits in the Warren Commission volume, and I added one very clear account from the book CBS Investigation Should We Now Believe the Warren Report. I know the answer is no, but my point was that these three different categories of witnesses all represent pieces of the puzzle. Well, two categories, the third one of the puzzle. So those who clearly describe three rapid shots approximately equally spaced. Not exactly equally spaced, but, you know, bang, 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 or bang, 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 or bang, bang, bang. Except real quick, a lot of people said, I thought it was automatic fire, because somebody was pulling the trigger as fast as they could realign and fight. They weren't stopping to work the bolt or anything. A lot of Texans, as you well know, were very familiar with firearms. The proverbial pickup truck with a rack-mounted rifle in the back. In case they see a deer as they're driving along, something for it, and have dinner. The other one, group B, their recall in whole or in part, was more consistent with that acoustic evidence. What they said was they heard something like a group of shots, bangity bang bang, or bang bang, or bang 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 bang, or something. Da 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 da, the gas, and then bang, or bang bang, or something like that. But they heard something that sounded a lot like what the acoustic scientists claimed. The third group, those who recall was unclear, and I can only remember one shot and then I fainted, or I was in such a state of shock that I don't remember anything. That's not very helpful to be a witness. And the third group is those who were not asked to describe the sound of the shock. So most of those were on that famous last day of testimony taken in Dallas. And it was all done by Wesley J. Liebler, a wonderful, meticulous Warren Commission counsel, who, if any of you know something about Lieber, he's always been a great defender of the Warren Commission and his work with him. But he went through the whole day, sort of, he must have meant he had a little sheet of paper and said, we've got to depose all these witnesses, we're in a panic, get through them as fast as you can, don't worry about the detail, we just want to be able to say, we deposed them, and we took their questions. And that's what he did. He said, how many shots did you hear? I think I heard three. Okay, and where were you standing? I didn't ask him anything else about the shot. So that was why about something like 15 of the witnesses probably could have given evidence that would be very helpful to my analysis, but didn't. category A, B, and C. In category A, here's a typical witness. And he's typical of the majority of category A, three shots running rampant. He's riding in an open press car. I think Tom Dillard was in the same car, if I remember. They were in an open press car in the motorcade. They were just coming up to the Texas Club car and heard the sudden sound of gunshots. And here's what he said. Here's his testimony. What was your best estimate of the amount of time from the first to the last shot? 5 to 8 seconds. Then, this is what I think is the critical question, what's the breakdown between the shots? He said 3 to 4 seconds between the first and second, between the second and third, 2 seconds. They were very close together. Could have been more time between the first and second, I really can't be sure. Are you sure you heard 3 shots? Yes, sir. Okay. So that's a typical witness who had more space between shots 1 and 2 than between shots 2 and 3. Of all those witnesses in category 20, in category A, 28 out of 36, 78%, were similar to death. They said the interval from 1 to 2, I'll call it delta T 1 to 2, case level delta T. Delta T 1 to 2 was longer than delta T 2 to 3. Another 6 of the witnesses said the 3 shots were pretty evenly spaced. Then 2 witnesses out of 36 said delta T 2 to 3 was a bit longer. I'm not always sure exactly what makes it. Now, of those 36 witnesses, only 14 testified in detail about the time between the shots, according to their estimates in seconds. Now, the average delta T for 13 out of those 14, and I believe Mayor Cabell, because it sounds to me like he was on real slow motion. I don't know what he was taking that for. He estimated 15 seconds for the time from shot number one to the last shot, and I know that's pretty long, especially compared to everybody else. In statistical analysis, we usually throw out extreme outliers in the distribution. That the points are way off the average, if everything else is bunched close together. So for everybody else, the average time from first to third shot is 5.8 seconds. For everybody, for those 13 standard deviations, 1.1 seconds. That is, they all said 5.8, and two-thirds of them gave answers between 5.8 plus 1.1 and 5.8 minus 1.1. You don't need to be a statistician to understand what I said, but roughly the two-thirds of the distance of the witnesses brim. Now, one of the problems I've had in doing the analysis is that of those who said they heard a longer space between shots 1 and 2 and shots 2 and 3, of all of those, the proportion of those asked to give numerical data was not the same. I think it was about 50-50. So I've reweighted the averages by the total numbers in the categories of delta T 1, 2 short, delta T 1, 2 equals delta T 1, 3, and so forth. I've weighted what they said by the total numbers of similar witnesses. So I took an average for group A, of group A1, and applied that with the number of people in group A1 rather than the number who responded to the detailed question. It wouldn't actually change the final result very much, but it would change it a little bit. And I think this is probably less biased than just taking the stochastic. Here's the result. They said 3.4 seconds to constant and 2.2 seconds to the second interval. The ratio of those two is 1.55, and the statistical error on that ratio, that's the important thing, is small, 10% of the number. Now these are what are called standard errors of the average. This is a standard statistical estimate. And not to go into a lecture on statistical analysis, but any statistician will tell you that if you have a piece of data that gives you a number that good, that small a standard error, then you have to reject as a hypothesis, what you can call a null hypothesis. You test your data against some theory that you've got. And if you take the null hypothesis out of the rest of the theory that the interval between the second 2 shots were longer than the interval between the first 2, you reject it. probability that Alvarez was wrong according to the witness is 99.99%. That is pretty close to certainty. And I think I would say on the basis that the Alvarez hypothesis is wrong, that could not have been. If there were only three shots, they could not possibly have been the way he said. Okay? That's the first thing. And simply say this, as I say, there are too many people like Mr. Jackson to be explained by errors. You can't say, well, all the witnesses were wrong, Alvarez had the Nobel Prize, so he must have been right about business. You can't do that. That's not modern science. You don't do science on the basis of the person, you do it on the basis of the data. So Alvarez has a good idea. In fact, I think his visual analysis fundamentally is there. But his assumption is wrong. Now, there was also, you remember, a second group, group B. There are 10 witnesses in this category. They described a bunch of closely spaced shots, then a long gap, and then more shots than a single shot. Gene Hill is a very good example of this category being witnessed. Gene seems to tell something that the number of shots is more like what Alvarez concluded. And in fact, during the House Select Committee testimony, one of the scientists reanalyzing Alvarez's work on the further film said, Mr. Congressman, there could have been any number of shots in there. We can't tell how many shots there are from the visual analysis. We can just say there were shots at this point in the film. Later in the film, there weren't. And then again, there was one at the end that we don't even need the visual to see it. Now, Jean Hill, as we all know, she was the one in the red dress, red coat, standing behind the limousine on the grass in the sequence that the car passes towards frame 313. Now, rather than write down all the questions and answers, I'll just paraphrase what she said. And I've taken this out of her testimony in her own words. I may have used just a couple of little link words to make it dramatic because she was answering questions. But essentially, this is what she said. I think there were four or five shots, maybe six, but there were more than three. The first shot sounded like this could be fired with bolt action rifle, one right after the other. I'm not quite sure what she means by that, but maybe she meant you could work the bolt in some right at that time. There were one right after the other, bang, bang, bang. Then there was a distinct pause, then I heard more. These were different, quicker, more automatic, worked together on the acoustic. I almost swear I've heard five and six, certainly no more than six. I think this is that we probably had difficulty finding something. There's another chap named Richard Worrell. He was standing in front of the Texas School of Auditory Musical Paraphrase. This testimony. I heard four shots, but it's not like what the acoustic gave us. When I heard the first shot, it was too loud to be a firecracker. I looked straight up. I saw the gun sticking out. He was quite specific about the percentage of the barrel and stuff. Is that about right for the command to test on the television site? Do you have 4 inches of barrel bar on beyond the truck? Is that accurate?
Right.
That's pretty damn good, I suggest. So there's something about this guy that tells you he's a good observer. Fired again, I saw a little flame of smoke come out of the barrel. Now, in fact, it was sitting on a ridicule, but a witness saw it and was there, oh, smoke. But actual tests show you do get a little smoke of flame. You do get something visible anyway when the light is fired. I glanced toward the president. We don't know if it was that light, but it was just something to get at. I glanced toward the president. He was slumping. In this case, glanced toward the president, saw his head come off. I stopped at the president. He said he glanced and saw the president slumping. And if you look at the previous one again, you know, the JFK was first doing this, and as time goes on before the fatal shot, he didn't go to the expansion. It was about a 30-degree angle by the time that last shot was fired, the paper shot was fired. And he was slumping. I looked up again, turned to run, a third shot was fired. Everyone was screaming. Notice that? Distraction. I ran to the corner of the building. As I got to it, I heard a fourth shot. She had time to run around, get to the corner of the building. He was probably running through crowds. Everybody was screaming.
indicated they were writing to profession. I'm not sure exactly what they meant by that, but that. So the question is, if most witnesses say three shots, the six seconds, the crucial film shows the whole assassination for something like 6 to 7 seconds. How can the first class of witnesses be reconciled with the second class A, three shots, and class B? And the answer is that eyewitness estimates of time, duration, are distorted. Now, I've made a study of dozens of experiments published in the literature, either in forensic journals or in psychology journals, of experiments done in classes, not different in any significant way from the one that I did to you earlier tonight. And we'll see what the results of those are at the end of my talk. Would it be all right to have the air conditioning on?
Yes.
Won't disturb the sound of the I dragged myself through the literature. I went to the most arcane libraries to find them. There's one paper published in 1895. I think the very first one on the question of eyewitnesses. The very first paper that I know about that actually goes into things like how long did something take. I've got a photocopy of that one if anybody wants to see it. But I found dozens of papers, and I stopped searching for the exact amount of information when I found the results. It was such a consistent that 50 more such experiments wouldn't change my opinion by very much. This scale here is what we call a logarithmic scale. That is, each equal step is a factor of 2 larger. Or here, each step is a factor of 10 larger. So it's a method of compressing a lot of data over a large span of values into a graph. Here's the ratio of the factor of 2. And you can see that most of the data are pretty close to that, between 2, 2.5, or even 3. Actually, 3 would be up about there. Most of it is between 2 and 2.5 times. So that means if something actually takes 3 seconds, a typical bunch of witnesses will say 6 seconds. The average. Some of them will do it at night. Some of them will do like Mayor Carroll and say 15 seconds or something like that. But on the average, you take up a little bit of because if notice, none of them ever get it right. No, it's just something you have to know. And I'm not the first person to, of course, call attention to this. If you've read a book by Elizabeth Lawson called Eyewitness Testimony, she mentions that kind of things rather briefly, and it's one of the many things that eyewitnesses get wrong about time. In fact, if you have an eyewitness reenact something, they'll reenact it with the right speech, but they'll say that the amount of seconds involved is twice, about twice as big. This is someone I can talk to. Said, you know, sometimes you hear people say, God, it all happened. Time just seems to stand still. Everything happened in slow motion. You know, when the car went over the cliff and they were all screaming with their eyes, and that sort of thing. So I think the actual duration was somewhere around 3 seconds. Of those 3 shots, not 6 seconds. I've never yet found that one of these experiments that they got the time even possible. Now, let's look at algorithm signal analysis again. The first signal is frame 181. Governor Connolly, in that famous Life magazine issue, went back over the testimony and over the Zapruder film in a very high quality individual frame slide, making frames transparent. We need to look at it. And he confirmed that the investigative ability to judge, he was wounded about here, frame 235. Found that shot would have reached Zapruder about 240. There is indeed a little bit there. We assume that this might be the long deck. It might well not be the shot here. But remember that the Zapruder camera was supposed to be running at 18.3 frames per second. And that says shot 1 to 3,
those witnesses, the first three shots. Those three, first for this shot, the number one, this shot, the number three, we can see the second one must have had somewhere about here, but it didn't necessarily cause the move, but did cause quickly. Now, okay, I'm telling you fine guy, right? One guy's up. Interpretation of data against the Nobel Prize. Okay. Actually, Chief of Police Curry gave a new testimony that corroborates what I just said in a rather remarkable way, because nobody noticed what he said and done the arithmetic in his testimony by the resulting system. He said our T13 was 5%. He was the only witness in all 72 who was asked to express his perceptions in terms of the position of his car. Now, you all know cars that have an American car in them, they're about 19 feet long, 18 feet long. And they don't differ much from that. To make a really good estimate, you know how many car lengths you travel between events. And we know the speed of a limousine was actually 11.8 miles per hour. Well, we know from testimony that they were trying to keep the limousines and three police cars further within as close together, as constant distance. So indeed, Curry was going at 11.8 miles per hour, or 12 miles an hour, near enough to manage. Then was asked, and this is asking about the position of the president's car, of course, he's talking about the position of his own car. He wasn't looking over his shoulder, testifying about the president's car at all. Can you give us the approximation where it was when you heard the second shot? Just a few feet further. Each shot was very rapid. Give you questions. How many feet can you use? Wonderful questions. I wish they'd all been asked something like this. I'd say this is just an estimate. 25 or 30 feet further on. Now, when you're driving, reasonably well, especially if you have your own car as an approximate measurement. You all know, you know, you can tell the difference if you're driving 25 miles an hour or 50 miles an hour. I hope you can, otherwise, let me know where you're driving by the time you Then just look at the time first, third shot, a few feet further, 15, 20 feet. Okay? Now compare 25 to 30 feet, 15 to 20 feet. Ratio is almost exactly 1.65. That's what I got from what the witnesses said. Then Curry's testimony was off about something else that actually time up. But look, 12 miles an hour, 17.6 feet per second. So Curry's disassessment can be converted into time by using time and distance divided by speed. The result is you get from Curry's testimony that T12 is 1.4 and 1.7 seconds. And T23 is 0.9 to 1.1 seconds. So about 1.6 seconds and 1.1 seconds, something like that. And if you go back and look at the witnesses said in group A and B, sorry, group A, if you correct for their factor of two errors, that's pretty much what they said. So why all these witnesses reported on the three shots? In most cases, only the first three shots. Why do they not report the other shots? Well, first of all, we have testimony from Muskie, Officer Baker, revved up the car to the extent. Has anybody got a hard to get here? And that's the one who does. You know what it's like when they rev one of those things up to get here? You agree with
that? I'm afraid
of my It's pretty noisy. And if you've got a police officer on a Harley Davidson, he's in a hurry, he tromps on that accelerator, or twists the handlebar accelerator. It makes a lot of noise, all the people standing right next to it. So that's one thing that's going to distract them. They distract from any other sound or shock. But what else is going on during that time period? People were screaming. And a lot of the testimony. After they heard three shots, everybody screamed and panicked. People dove to the ground. There was that famous discussion. I remember things when he dropped to the ground with his family. And Yarborough said that man's been in the military, I think.
filing a shocking event in office caused subsequent events not to register fully in the memory. And this is actually something that many psychologists have told me that this is one of the other things that can occur. Excellent example in the testimony. This, Mary much more. Took the much more film of the assassination. You may have seen it. It isn't very detailed. It's not something that gives you a lot of diagnosis of what happened. And there is a gap in the film between the motorcade going up Houston Street, turning off the film, and a little sequence at the end when you go to the head of the film. But I can't believe that she was never asked to testify. Didn't know why, and somebody does.
Shouldn't that be normal?
No, Mary Muchmore.
Mary Muchmore.
Mary Muchmore took the film. Mm-hmm. Mary Mormon was the one with Gene Field who took the photo.
Yeah. Where was Mary Muchmore with Dealey Plaza?
Mary Muchmore was standing near the corner of Main and Houston.
Oh, right.
Just by the end of the long retirement thing. Little motorcade turning onto
Houston. When they made the 90-degree turn.
As the motorcade turned onto Elm, she struck the camera, went around the other side, onto the grass.
Right.
And from a position,
Where Orville Nix was, somewhere around there.
Yeah, she was a little bit behind him, I think.
A little behind
him.
Yeah. So she had a view of the car coming.
She could see Elm Street and the car going down. She filmed that.
Yeah, she scanned that.
I don't remember why I said that. I'll check that.
Okay.
She took much more film, whatever her name is. But regardless, maybe I couldn't find her because she didn't have the name on her. I think she didn't testify. She took up an important piece of evidence, and they didn't get her to testify. They didn't even get her to give that statement. I think she may still be one of those witnesses for them. And the police. That was it. So she didn't respond. So here we got he must have interviewed her or read a statement or something. So he says what she said she heard. So the Warren Commission didn't want to do it. Oh, amazing. I couldn't believe it. No, it's not a risk. It changed that. She photographed the motorcade and turned into the incident and she was down Houston. She says she heard the chomp panic. Didn't take any pictures. And she says, but you look at her film, then you have film of the motorcade going down Elm Street. She doesn't remember anything about it. So we, unfortunately, we only have secondhand testimony on the hearsay. Well, again, this model of the number of shops we recognize, is 57. Assuming 57 is valid, of course. We've all read there are only two shops that can be considered in the first part of the two pieces, according to the thank you. There is another input on the thesis report. Dr. Barger, with three impulses. You take the first one to be 0 seconds, the second one is 1.65 seconds, and the third was 2.75 seconds. In other words, almost exactly what the witnesses were saying say, on average, if you correct them by a factor of two, for the general tendency of all witnesses, there is another impulse. Well, why wasn't that in the health select committee's final report? What happened to that impulse of 2.75 seconds? It was rejected because you can't fire a manager across time on a car being that rapid. You can't work the bolt in 1.1 seconds to get off another time. Okay, so we've now got the assumption that it had to all be done with Uncle Sarkana in Oslo. And if you can't fit something in, you have to reject your scientific statement. There is that logical reason to say, logical chapter, that's a political reason for rejecting the impulse. It's certainly not a scientific reason. It's true that the average probability of these impulses in the analysis were not 99.99%. But
Colonel Rowan?
Yeah.
Okay.
So he, I'm sure, was telling the truth. But they really worked very hard to impeach him. There were people who weren't asked by the Warren Commission for this, but they saw two men, some of them saw two rifles. The impulse timing that they agreed extremely well was properly interpreted by the film measurements, I think, can readily be interpreted to agree that the three early shots were spaced just under 60 seconds. The early shot, I think, the frame 177 to 180. Probably this is the car. The cause of JFK has been drawn down and turned dead sharply until it disappears. Another shot wounds JFK just before he comes out from behind the time. Third one, this comes following around frame 65. Witnesses in category B are then also seem to agree that the full picture is seen from the distance to this one and with the acoustic state. In fact, you don't have to believe the acoustic state since that's my description. But it is remarkable, I think, that this much denigrated acoustic state, in fact, agrees extremely well. Look back to shock. Stop assuming that there was only one rifle and you couldn't work both of them, and start thinking about security. So, conclusion. Number one, eyewitness accounts of the timing of the shot tells us that three shots close together over about 3 seconds, followed by one or two shots at 7 seconds. The sequence is consistent with events seen in the computer film. Remember, you also didn't know
the form.
You still have a result. Okay.
Yeah, I was still right.
Third one. Facing the shots are so close together. Facing the shots are so close together that the answer is somehow can't be fired. Both can't be worked that fast, but it had to have been two guns somewhere in the Flinders Repository or Dallas Tech Building. The acoustic state does not rule out the Dallas Tech Building. And there have been many people who have been suspicious of that for a long time, that there was a gunman somewhere in Dallas Tech. It's also fully consistent with the general analysis of the film and the acoustic evidence, but I don't rely upon it in any way. Now, okay. So I'm finished with my talk, but Isabel has given me the results of the analysis. I can't read with the lights off, but he has turned the lights on. I'll show you what we have. No. Oh, yes, now I can.
Okay.
How many shots?
This one is the number of shots. This one is the number of arms.
Okay. Now, one person said they heard two shots. Six people heard three shots. One said three or four, five said four, and six said five shots. Two said six shots, one said seven, and one said ten. The average number of shots that you all heard was less. The correct number of shots was five. Gonna have to work across me here from what you said. First shot out, what's remarkable to me is that most of you actually got the interval between the first and second shot about right. You said about six people said 1 second, four people said 1.5, and five people said two, and the rest of you were sort of outside the distribution there. So you're all putting the line to what I said, because you've all estimated the average to be about 2 seconds. Well, the interval between 2 and 3 is 1.2 seconds. Now here, you all again still say 2 seconds or longer. So the average that I'm getting here is somewhere around 2 seconds.
So I don't know whether that proves anything. Of course, you were not naive witnesses, and you're all used to the idea of thinking about the chops and the penalties. And I hope you don't mind my having pulled a little test and experiment on you. It would be fun to try this with an audience that doesn't know so much about this afternoon. And without lots of students here, the consultants might seem quite scientific working on this. So thank you all very much. I'm through here, online.
We've had questions, right? Did anybody have any questions?
So, how many shots have fired on the day then?
Well, it's interesting, you have five and I have five. That's kind of interesting. No, I have five from the.
Well, the important thing is that you didn't all say five.
Yeah.
My point is that I collected up all the early accounts before they had the newspapers and the wire service, and the four shots were fired at Lincoln and so forth. Actually, it was something like about 89 shots. And they were very, very close together, so I can understand why people didn't count them right. And they were depending on actual recordings and things like that. Many, many shots. But again, people could count for something. So, if they're put on the spot, say, is that all you heard? Yes. It's quite common that businesses don't remember the number of shots. And that's in general, if there are a lot of shots, they count too. But they're busy doing something else and thinking about something else.
It is remarkable how close they were, 99.99% of the first group of witnesses here, how close their analysis.
Well, the 99.99% is the probability with which you have to throw out all the rest of the conclusion that there were three shots and they bunched the way he says, two close together and a long gap and then another.
That's remarkable.
Yeah, and you cannot accept Alvarez's construction, but if you look at post-adoption of the Warren Commission conclusion, and all other what I would call Warren Commission politics, they all put heavy weight on Alvarez's analysis.
Yeah.
It's got to be wrong, even if there were only two shots. It's wrong.
So that's quite critical.
Theory of yours called Alvarez could be pie in the sky, because then of course you've got to ask them, all those witnesses, where they think the shots come from. And of course then you've got another problem there straight away.
Well,
because then you're going to get a much more diversity of answers, surely. Because they're not all going to say the same. Some are going to say the picket fence, some are going to say above them, some are going to say, to the left.
Well, this was the thing with the analysis from the corporate. Was that inclusive line, and I wouldn't tell you anything important about where shots came from their sound. Most eyewitnesses weren't very well placed to judge where sound came from, and those out there would be impossible. In fact, they couldn't tell where the shots came from their sound.
If you look at the scenario there, five shots, basically you take wounds and
I haven't said anything about wounds other than the fact that Connolly looked at the previous film, the great material, and said, well, this is where I was best remember doing until I was shot. And suddenly here, I got this. That's what I was talking about. You look at the C frame further on, you got the lot, the whole roof shut. See, very clearly.
Well, it was in the bottom of that. Basically, there must have been more shots at the top of the tower. Because at least 30 minutes, there appears to be a possibility.
Why 15 minutes?
At least 30 minutes. Just one, stuck the tower, but the fragment hit the second. And there's also another shot that was seen hitting the storm drain.
I don't know whether the storm drain shot was ever really well established, but we're reading this.
What about the shot that hit the centre of the limousine console? Along the console limousine there was a bullet mark in the console. And,
well,
and also
it obviously wasn't a fresh bullet, more like a fragment. And remember, Connolly was hit by fragments and not possibly in his wrist and his leg, and not by the bullet that went through the chain. That could not have happened, thanks to the fire. And it was obvious, I don't know where it went.
Well, follow that up. Do you think some of the guns were silenced? And had silencers on
them? Well, the witnesses wouldn't have heard the shots.
I think there were more shots than I actually heard.
Well, it's possible there were guns that were silenced. But I mean, if you've got any guns, it's not a conspiracy. You have five guns, four guns. Why organize conspiracy with three of them are noisy and one is silent? No point. Even one gun is noisy, people are going to start wondering what's going on.
Do you think the first shot is going to be the fuse of that shot? Are you saying three guns are firing near enough to go?
Yeah. Well, I know three shots could not have been fired enough to find a bunch of people. Because those three shots can't be fired from the manifold or chrono type, right? And you just cannot work the bolt in 1.1 seconds. You just cannot work the bolt and sight it with what's called an iron sight in 1.65 seconds, which is the first one. You can't do it in that half second.
And what I mean is three different guns spaced to the head, fire at a second in the signal.
What kind of signal would you use? Umbrella?
Okay. You have to spot it with the gun and an ordinary signal from the radio.
All those things are possible, but of course I can't tell from the eyewitnesses whether any of those things had occurred.
The green one.
No, I can't tell what happened. I can't tell who shot who, I can't tell which shot was who, which shot was the one that missed. When he got this first shot, he would have had to be fired and he would be hidden by a tree. I can't see anybody who would have been fired by a tree. I can't see. So that shot came from someone else, but the problem was from the shot on the history. I think it probably came from the one that would have been. There are lots of windows open in
Belfast.
No, it goes from, I've cited all the papers I found of the literature up to 1980. I don't think the psychology of witnesses suddenly changed much.
No, they might have been aware of that in 1963.
Sorry?
They would have been aware of that. A lawyer in a case.
I think in 1963 there probably wasn't much case law that depended on a general time exaggeration. The other question would have been over what time span are these exaggerations logical? data tends to be happening at the street. I wouldn't have expected anybody to have done this analysis, but I would have expected them to pay close attention to the what the witnesses said when they were doing things like legal analysis. The truth is a contradiction. It's a blatant contradiction of probably 99.99 of one of those two things is wrong. Either all the witnesses are lying or completely deluded about what they have heard, despite the fact that they're all consistent and tell the same story. Or some assumption that went into the digital analysis conclusion that is wrong. And I've got time to go, I'll say, well, let me check my assumption to see if I can find some correction.
Yeah, but when a lot of the witnesses, and all at least one of them, he was told that he must have heard only three shots by the first interviewing him, that there wasn't anything
there
to
was
say what there was
yeah,
called.
I didn't want to go into this. There was a lot of social connection as long as I want. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there were a lot of cases where I think there was very strong pressure. Subtle ways, sometimes not so subtle. Give answers like, yeah, I only heard three times. One of the best was, I remember his name now, but I've got to know that it's someone else. His testimony was terrific. He gave his testimony about how many shots he heard. He was asked, how many shots did you hear? And he said, well, I heard one more than was fired that day. Okay. The world, sometimes guns, a lot of them stuck to this. Moral and others get their integrity and say, well, that's what I heard.
Yeah.
You know, that's what I'll say. I don't want to lie for posterity. Going down to the course people look to me to see, I can only say what I thought I heard. I can't say what you want me to say. In fact, what you stood up and say. These people have a lot of respect. But equally true to say, if you said they only heard three shots, so telling the truth is best that they knew.
Any more questions? Mike, thank you very much.
Yeah, okay.